Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to the regathering, part quattro, the fourth one of our regathering time together. It is good to see all of you who are with us today. We are excited to worship our Lord and our God. We are here to praise His name. We are here to listen to His word. We are here to experience His spirit. For where two or more are gathered in my name, Jesus says, I will be there. And we believe that He is with us through the power of the Holy Spirit here today. I want us to begin our worship, if you would, to stand on your feet. We want to praise and sing about how good our Lord and God is.
Lord, You are good and Your mercy endures forever. Lord, You are good and Your mercy endures forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship You. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship You for who You are. We worship You. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship You for who You are. You are good. Lord, You are good and Your mercy endureth forever. Lord, You are good and Your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship You. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship You for who You are. We worship You. Hallelujah, hallelujah. We worship You for who You are. You are good.
Water You turn into wine, open the eyes of the blind, there's no one like You, none like You. Into the darkness You shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like You. Unlike You. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Into the darkness You shine, out of the ashes we rise, there's no one like You, none like You. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God.
A And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? What could stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God.
This is a day of worship and is also a day of prayer together. We will be doing an intercessory prayer that we've been doing the last few weeks in a little while. But for today, I want us to pause and have a few moments of silence with our heads bowed as we come to God in confessing ourselves. Would you join me in prayer? God of mercy, we confess that we've not borne the fruits of the Spirit. We have not loved others as you have loved us. We have, in effect, O Lord, denied the promises that you bring to us of baptism and cut ourselves off from you when we find it convenient. So, Lord, forgive us. Restore us and redeem us, that we may abide in your love, live out your mercy, for the sake of all those that we come in contact with, but Lord, most of all, for the sake of Jesus Christ, your Son, in whom we pray now. Amen. God has a power in his love that we seldom tap into, and we're going to be talking about that later today, but we want to sing about it now. Would you please stand with me as we sing two more songs together about God's love.
Lord, I come to you, let my heart be changed. Renewed, flowing from the grace that I found in you. Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away. Renew my mind.
Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hand, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. 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 Over the mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will open up my heart and let the healer set me free. I'm happy to be in the truth, and I will daily lift my hand, for I will always sing of when your love came down. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever. I could sing of your love forever.
Each week we who've gathered, been able to gather in place, and also been able to gather through our different sites that you can find us on, come together as God's people to pray for one another. And I'm inviting you to do that now with me as well. It is our intercessory prayer time, and you will see your part when it comes upon the screen. And your phrase is simply, hear our prayer. Let the people of God pray. O God, we give you thanks for your Holy Spirit, whose work at creation continues in us. Through Christ Jesus, you have shown your love for this earth that you made, and we pray that all the world may know your power and your goodness. God, who makes us one. Word of life, reveal the wonder of your world to all peoples. Show us anew what lives around us, or over us, beneath us, within us. Enliven the church with your Spirit, that we may honor your earth with responsible care. God, who makes us one. Almighty God, uphold our sisters and brothers who endure disasters that may be caused by weather, war, famine, sickness, or greed. Strengthen all who are in peril, for you are our refuge and strength, the very present help in times of trouble. God, who makes us one. Giver of all good things, bring trust and sympathy to the nations of the world. Let peacemakers reign wherever there is conflict. Give wisdom to leaders and hope to the poor. O God, who makes us one. Good healer, we pray for all who are in the need of comfort. So comfort those who mourn. Uphold those who are sick or holding vigil for this life to the next, or awaiting words of hope, especially those that we now silently name. God, who makes us one, hear our prayer. Trusting in your mercy, we commend to you all those we have named and those whose needs are known only to you. In the name of your Son, Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Our scripture this morning is going to be a continuing look at 1 John. We have been going over 1 John all summer, and we're getting kind of towards the end of things as we finish out the fourth chapter. But there is a lot still there for us to see and have God reveal to our lives today. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love. Now, by this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us. Sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. And by this we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he's given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world. And whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, well, God abides in him and he in God. So we have come to know and have believed the love which God has for us. God is love, and the one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. By this, love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment, because as he is, so also are we in this world. There's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves punishment, and the one who fears is not perfected in love. Now we love because he first loved us. And if someone says, well, I love God, and hates his brother, he's a liar. For the one who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. And this commandment we have from him, that the one who loves God should love his brother also. This is the word of the Lord, and thanks be to God for his word today.
Men of faith, rise up and see. Of the great and glorious King, you are strong when you feel weak, in your brokenness and grief. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus is Savior to all, Lord of heaven. Rise up, women of the truth, stand and sing to broken hearts, who can know the healing satisfying by the power of his name. We've fallen deeper in love with you. You put the truth on our lips. Rise up, church, with broken wings. Fill this place with songs again of our God who reigns on high. By his grace again we'll fly. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus the Savior to all, Lord of heaven and earth. Shout to the north and the south, sing to the east and the west, Jesus the Savior to all, Lord of heaven and
perfect love. Love is a many splendored thing. I'm all out of love. I'm so lost without you. Longer than there's been fishes in the ocean, I've been in love with you. Or from Trisha Yearwood. Yeah, this is perfect love. We're doing nothing but what a perfect love does. We're not trying to make history. It's just you and me in perfect love. Enough to make you sick, isn't it? Ugh. I think I need insulin now just having quoted those things. We all seem to strive and sing or to celebrate a perfect love. But here is what John tells us, and that is when love is coming from fallible human beings like us, how perfect can it really be? I mean, what does perfect love actually look like? Is there some place to cast our eyes, to write down our notes, to figure out what perfect love is, that we could know it better, and so that we could then turn around and be able to emulate that to those we love? Well, in this very important part of 1 John, all things have kind of keep gearing themselves, and this is kind of almost the high watermark of this entire sermon, letter, treatise, however you wish to call this epistle. And we are discovering something profound that underlies everything that has been said already as he goes back to the root writings that John shares with us, all the way back to the Gospels, into these epistles, love. In this first letter from John, he strikes an important note that we as followers and professors of Christ must adhere to. As he builds his note to the church, he is now to this most profound treatment of love. And so in those first few verses of the passage we've read, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. Everyone who loves is born and knows God. The one who does not love doesn't know God, for God's love." Very simple, you know, reasoning taking place. "By this the love of God was manifested in us. God sent his begotten Son, his only begotten Son, to the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but he loved us and sent his Son to die or be the propitiation of our sins." The first thing we notice is God is the source of perfect love. He notes that we do not have the ability nor the inherent nature to love like this. God alone does. All we have certain abilities within us to love those whom we like. I mean, that's easy, isn't it? Or to love to those whom we are attached. But the kind of love that John is speaking is not a natural given in the human psyche. It is a love that only comes from above, that comes from God, that, you know, descends upon us. In fact, at the beginning of this, he pointed that very thing out, that we must be born of this love. Only those who have seen the source of God's love can share this kind of love. Because the only source for perfect love is God himself. It's the essential part, because it is essential character to God. God's great central character is rooted in God's love. Oh, there are other parts of God's character. Hear me on that. But it all goes back to God's love to create, love to love that which God has created, and love to save and redeem what has been broken in that creation. And he continues down even to verse 10 when he goes so far as to point out this love is seen rather than just spoken. God loved us first and did something about it through the death of Jesus, his Son, his only Son. So love is by divine disclosure, if you will. It is God thing. For John, the criteria of who knows God and who doesn't is manifested by actions on behalf of God's love. What we do matters in order to verify what we say. It's one thing to say it. It's another thing to live it. Henry Drummond, the Scottish minister, wrote, "He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God is love. Therefore, love. Love without distinction, calculation, procrastination, just love. Lavish it upon the poor where it's very easy, especially upon the rich who often need it most. Most of all, upon our equals, where it is very difficult, and for whom perhaps we do the least of all." Even the great C.S. Lewis, that author, scholar, said, "Don't waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor. At least act as if you did." As soon as we do this, as soon as we perhaps act on it, we find one of the great secrets he wrote about. He said, "When you are behaving as if you love someone, you will presently come to eventually love him. If you injure someone you dislike, you will find yourself disliking him more. So if you do him a good turn, you'll find yourself disliking him less." that is love in action. But we can't do it. Only God can, because God is our source. We can do things that only God can do because God abides within us, John is saying. Not our own strength, but the strength of God. And it's seen. When it is seen, it impacts lives. Some years ago, a Johns Hopkins professor gave a group of grad students an assignment. He said, I want you to go to the more impoverished area of our city. I want you to take 200 boys between the ages of 12 and 16 and investigate their background and environment. And then when you come back, I want you to have written for me an idea of predicting their chances for their future. The students, after consulting social statistics, talking to the boys and compiling much data, concluded that 90% of the boys would spend some time in jail. Well, 25 years later, another group of graduate students was given the job by this same professor of testing the prediction. They went back to the same area looking for the same group of boys that had been written about 25 years earlier in that project. Were they still there? Well, some were. And a few had died, and some had moved away. But they pretty much got in touch with 180 of the original 200. And they found that only 4 of that entire group ever was incarcerated. Only 4 out of that 200. Well, why was it that these men who had lived in a breeding place for crime had such a surprisingly good record to avoid it? And the researchers were continually told by these people they talked to, well, you see, there was this teacher. And when the interviewer would press further, found out that in 75% of the cases, they discovered the teacher they were talking about was the same woman. The researchers went to this teacher, now living at home, retired. May all God's teachers get to that point at some time in their lives. And they asked her, how had she exerted such remarkable influence over that group of children? Could she give them some reason why these boys would have remembered her? And she just said, no, I really couldn't. I just taught. And then thinking back over the years, she said almost musingly to herself, more than to the interviewer students, she said, you know, I just love those boys. John continues, beloved, if God so loved us, we ought to love one another. I mean, you haven't seen God at any time, and if we love one another and God abides in us, his love becomes perfected in us. And by this we know that we abide in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. We have seen and we testify that the Father has sent the Son to be the Savior of the world, and whoever confesses Jesus as Son of God, well, then God abides in him and he in God. And we come to know and have believed the love which God has for us. The experience of perfect love is in God, your experience with God. Our faith will take us there. It requires the beginning step, which is believing in Christ. When we do that, then we begin to love as Christ loves if we allow Christ's love to live within us. We change our priorities in this life. And love, the love that God reveals, must be the driving force behind what we do in our lives. Did you ever get in a situation when you wanted to respond or to retort and you just went ahead and did it and regretted it? But when you were in the same situation of responding or reacting or retorting back to someone, you stopped for a moment and thought, what is the purpose of this dialogue? Is Christ in the midst of what I'm about to say back? And normally we scroll on down because that's love. That's God's love within us. What is the purpose? It doesn't mean we don't speak out when we ought to, but it means that what we speak must always find its way through God's love. We must realize that we practice love. Well, what does it look like? Well, perhaps this illustrates it best. There were two brothers working in on the family farm. One was married and had a large family. The other was single. And at the day's end, the brothers shared everything equally, produce and profit. One day, the single brother said to himself one evening, he said, it's not right that, you know, we share equally the produce and the profit because I'm just by myself. My needs are pretty simple. But my brother has all this family to feed and take care of. And so each night he would take one extra sack of grain and he would take it out of the bin, creep across the field that separated their homes and their barns and such, and dumped it into his brother's bin. Meanwhile, the married brother said to himself, you know, it's not right that we should divide everything just equally. After all, I'm married. I've got a wife and I've got children to look after me in years to come to support me and love me. My brother has no one and no one to take care of him. So each night he took a bag of grain out of the bin and marched across that field to put in his brother's bin. Till one evening, as the moon was not out and it was a little more dark than usual, they literally bumped into each other like some old Andy Griffith episode. And slowly it dawned on them what was happening, and they simply dropped their sacks and embraced one another. That was pre-COVID, by the way. That's what love looks like. Christ's love is as simple as that. No matter who you are, how gifted you are or are not, we all have the potential to love like Christ if he dwells within us, John says. In last week's Wednesday Bible study, we read from Mark chapter 10 that Jesus tells us rather plainly when we were talking about it that the greatest of us is the least of us. The first is last and the last is first. That God's love reveals us to that truth and allows us to be comfortable to be at the back of the line. Because the presence of God is with me, whether I'm in the back of the line or the front of the line. Everyone has the hope of this love from God, our Redeemer. And it comes to each of us, even the simplest of us. Peter was a man with Down syndrome. And he expressed one day to a small group in his church, when somebody asked of them, what do you do to serve God? And Peter responded, I like to pray. So the person said, well, that's good, Peter. What do you do when you pray? And he replied, I listen. And then the person asked what God said to him. And here Peter, this man who has severe handicaps, as the world sees, looked up and simply said, well, he just says, you're my beloved son. And that's all I need. When someone has lived most of his or her life in the last place and discovers Jesus is there in the last place as well, it is truly good news. For God is love, and the one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him, and by this love becomes perfected with us. So we have confidence, he says. The day of judgment, we have confidence, not because of ourselves, but because of Christ dwelling within us. Because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, he says, but perfect love gets rid of fear. In other words, if you dwell long enough in God's love, fear no longer becomes a holding point of emotion upon you. Because fear, he says, is about punishment. You don't have to fear if God's love becomes perfected in you. And by the way, that doesn't mean we cross the goal line, we spike the ball because one day we reach perfection. It's the understanding and the way that word is written that it continues on in you. I mean, we love, he says, because why? Well, he first loved us. If someone says, I love God and hates his brother, well, he's a liar. Because you can't love your brother whom you've seen and then say you love God whom you've not seen. Commandment we have from him that the one who loves God should love his brother also. There is a confidence of perfect love that God gives us. And that confidence is found in God working within us. John, in essence, says the experience of God's perfect love provides a fearless confidence not in our righteousness, but in God's righteousness. Sometimes one's confidence can be shaken, and you can understand in certain places and moments. One of the things that in the roughly 3 years in which we knew that my father was dealing with ALS and with Lou Gehrig's disease, of all those 3 years or so, anybody who was around him, and this isn't to make him Superman, it's to understand that I think this is what God does in our lives, he never really said anything about how unfair or how horrible his sentence of health was. It just never really bothered him that way. And by the end, he had this unbelievable confidence that God was still at work. Probably just a few months before he died in October of 87, there was a made-for-television movie that dealt with a young woman who developed ALS and her husband, and dealt with a lot of issues that went with that. And my mom told me the story that she said she and Dad had watched this together. And I, of course, had watched it when I was, and that was at seminary. And after we had a chance to talk about it, I said, "Did you watch the movie?" And Mom said, "Yes." And I said, "Man," because towards the end of that movie, it gets kind of rough. You know, there's no muscle left. You know, you can't communicate except through tapping your head on something, and it's like you're trapped inside your body, which is what ALS does. And I said, "So how did y'all take that?" She said, I looked at him afterwards, and I said, "Now, JC, we've got to deal with this. We've got to realize that this might very well be what happens to you." And he said, "No, I don't have to worry about that. It's not going to get that way." "Well, what do you mean it's not going to get that way?" He said, I've been praying, Sue. And he said, "You know, all I've asked of God is just take me, but if you can, Lord, just take, I'm just going to trust you to take me before it gets to that point." And he looked at Mom and he said, "And you know, God's never let me down yet. And I don't think he will now." And he didn't.